While this story has been traditionally called the parable of the prodigal son or the parable of the lost son, I think we ought to rename it the parable of a father and his two prodigal sons. There were two prodigal sons in this story. There are two lost boys. One prodigal who commits open, obvious, public sins, and another prodigal who commits sins of the heart. One prodigal who's in the far country, and the other prodigal who stays at home. One prodigal who was caught up in the world, and the other prodigal who goes to church every Sunday. And both of them were lost. One boy left home and went into a far country, but the other boy, while he stayed at home, his heart was just as far from the father's heart. Jesus showed pity on people who committed open, obvious, public sins. Remember the woman caught in adultery? He told her, go and sin no more. But he was much harsher on self-righteous folk. Remember, he called the Pharisees hypocrites. He said, on the outside, you look like whitewashed tombs, but on the inside, you're full of dead men's bone. And Lloyd Ogilvie suggested that while there's some of both of these boys in all of us, but most of us can identify with the elder brother. The elder brother is a look into the mirror for most of us. What were the sins of the elder brother? I'm glad you asked. First of all, he was self-righteous. He says in verse 29, these many years I've been serving you. I've been slaving for you. I never transgressed your commandment. I never left home, but you never gave me a party. But as soon as this boy, this son of yours came home, you threw a party for him, and that's not right. He thought that he had been good enough to earn his father's love. He did not understand the true meaning of sonship. He thought, child of God, that sonship could be merited, but sonship can't be merited. It has to do with your disposition of your heart toward the Father. He thought that because he stayed home, that it made him deserving of his Father's favor, and because his younger boy brother left home, it made him undeserving of his Father's favor. It was his way of implying that he was spiritually and morally superior to his brother, and this is self-righteousness at its peak. He didn't understand that the far country is not measured by geographical measurement, but the far country is measured by the disposition of your heart toward the Father. And Saint Augustine said that a darkened heart is the far country. This boy had a darkened heart. I say there are two lost boys in this parable. No, you don't drink. No, you don't smoke dope. No, you don't chase skirts nor pants. But what about the self-righteousness that's in your heart? Self-righteous people always look at other people's sins as being greater than theirs. They try to stratify sin. And so they say to the wino that you drink too much when you weigh 700 pounds. Instead of you telling him that he drinks too much, you ought to consider the fact that you eat too much. And gluttony is just as much a sin as alcoholism. There are two prodigals. Two prodigals. You don't drink. You don't smoke dope. You don't chase skirts nor pants. But if you got a self-righteous spirit that makes you think you are superior, that you are the spirit, you're the church's FBI agent. You're the sin detector in the church. Now sweep around your own front door before you try to sweep around mine. There are two prodigals, two lost boys. One boy in the club, other boy in the choir. Both of them lost. He was self-righteous. But wait. When you look at the sins of the elder brother, he was judgmental. Or rather, he was jealous. Let me go there first. He was jealous. For you see, he said to his daddy, "You never gave me a goat. You never gave me a party. I stayed at home and did everything you told me to do. I dotted my I's. I crossed my T's. But you never gave me a party." This boy failed to see how good his father had daily been in his own life, because he couldn't get his eyes off the fact that his father had done something nice for his brother. And how many people come to church every Sunday, but you cannot worship God with a pure heart because you got a jealous spirit? You keep looking at what God is doing for somebody else. Nobody has everything. Everybody has something. If you learn how to thank God for the little something you got instead of worrying about what somebody else has, maybe God would bless you with more. No! You don't drink. No! You don't smoke dope. No! You don't chase skirts nor pants. But what about the jealousy that's in your heart? When you measure your success based on somebody else's failure, or your failure based on somebody else's success, it tells me you've got a jealous spirit. And here's the lesson of this story. Jesus is trying to teach the self-righteous Pharisees that sins of the heart are just as wrong as open, obvious, public sin. No. You don't drink. No. You don't smoke dope. No, you don't chase skirts nor pants. But if you got a jealous heart, it keeps you from having a right relationship with the Lord. But wait, there's another sin of the elder brother, and that is he was judgmental. He says in verse 30, "But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you kill the fatted calf for him." Notice now that he adds assumed sins to the list of his younger brother's sins. That were not mentioned. We wasn't told anything about harlots. But judgmental people are not only quick to point out the sins of others, they're also quick to point out the assumed sins of others. Ah, but they fail to see the sin that is in their own eyes. Jesus said, "Judge not that you be not judged." And why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but fail to see the beam, the plank that is in your own eye? Remember, whenever you point the finger of accusation at somebody else, three fingers are pointing back at you. No, you don't drink. No, you don't smoke dope. No, you don't chase skirts nor pants. But what about the judgmentalism that's in some of our hearts? I suspect that the older son was jealous of the sins of the younger son. Sleeping with harlots, living the wild life. Maybe those were his fantasies. It was as if he said, "You know what? He got to go off and have all the fun. And you gave him a party. And I stayed home living this boring life. And you never gave me a party." Maybe those were his fantasies. No, you didn't take that last draw on that joint. But you wanted to. Huh. No, you didn't cross that line when that other person flirted with you. But you wanted to. There are two prodigal sons in this passage. And could it be that the reason the younger boy wanted to leave home in the first place, because he couldn't stand being around his jealous, judgmental, self-righteous older brother? And it might be that that's what's running folk away from the church. It's the elder brother people that are running folk from the church. You pseudo-righteous, fictive righteous, think you're righteous, but you ain't righteous folk. No, no, no. No, no, you don't drink. No, you don't smoke dope with your self-righteous self. No, you don't chase skirts nor pants. But what about the judgmental spirit that you have? You always have an opinion about what somebody else has done or is alleged to have done. But you fail to take an inward look at your own heart. I say to you that there are two prodigals in this passage. And as the passage ends, the younger son is in the house, enjoying fellowship with the father. But the older boy is outside. Nobody shut him out. He shut himself out by his judgmental, jealous, self-righteous spirit. Do I have a witness here? But wait a minute as I back away from this parable. And as I look at this parable through the lenses of whole Bible theology, I think I see another prodigal in this passage. Because the word prodigal not only means wasteful, but Lord Ogilvie said it means extravagant, lavish, unrestrained, and copious. Don't those adjectives describe the father? Don't they describe the love that the father showed his sons? I see the prodigal father who loved his sons with a lavish love, who loved his sons with an extravagant love, who loved his sons with an unrestrained love. Do I have a witness here? He loved his son with prodigal love. It is the prodigal father that I see in this passage. I don't know about you, child of God, but the reality is that that's the only reason that I'm here tonight. It's not because of how good I've been. It's not because of how well I've kept God's commandments. I'm here tonight, child of God, because of God's unrestrained love. Yes, you are here tonight because of his extravagant love. You are here tonight because of his copious love. We are here tonight because of his prodigal love. Because the reality is, I don't know why he loved me. Yes, child of God, and I don't know why he cares. And I don't know why he would sacrifice his life. But oh, I'm glad. I'm so glad that he did. He loved me when I was right. And he loved me when I was wrong. He loved me when I was up. But he loved me when I was down. He loved me, child of God, in my sins. He loved me when I was too mean to live and wasn't fit to die. Can I get a witness? Is there anybody here that can testify that the only reason you are still alive is because he loved you? Can I get a witness? I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply I was stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea, he heard my despairing cry. From the waters he lifted me, and now saved
life am I? What was it that lifted you? It wasn't your education. It wasn't where you went to school. It wasn't who you knew downtown. But love lifted me, lifted you. Love, unspeakable love. Love that money can't buy. Love that cold can't freeze. Love that fire can't burn. Love, love lifted me. Can I get a witness? Good day, y'all. But in a few minutes, we're going to the table, and everything about that table reminds us of how much he loved us. He loved us enough to die on the cross. He loved us enough to shed his precious blood. He loved us enough to get up from the grave with all power in his hand. Can I get a witness? Tell somebody, I thank God because he loved me. I thank God for giving me a house. I thank God for giving me a car. All of that's good, but I thank him most for reaching down and lifting me up, placing my feet on solid ground. Yeah, yes, yes, oh yeah, yeah.